know, God, that you didn't just start knocking today, but you've been knocking for a while.
Yes.
And we pray, God, that they would respond to that subtle knock on their heart, saying, come home to me. And so, God, we thank you for this preaching moment. We thank you, God, for the privilege of sharing. And we pray, God, that both saint and sinner would be blessed and that you would be glorified in all things. So, Father, we thank you. We praise you, we honor you, and we adore you. In the blessed, wonderful, and mighty name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Somebody ought to say amen.
Amen.
I'm going to invite you to join me in the Old Testament book of Jeremiah. Jeremiah, 9th chapter, and I'm going to read for us verses 23 and 24. The Word of God reads, thus saith the Lord, let not the wise man glory in his wisdom, neither let the mighty man glory in his might. Let not the rich man glory in his riches, but let him that glorieth glory in this,
amen,
that he understandeth and knows me, and that I am the Lord which exercises loving kindness, judgment, and righteousness in the earth. For in these things I delight,
amen,
saith the Lord.
Amen.
And so this morning I want to talk from the thought, what makes God happy?
Amen.
What makes God happy? Text. You don't have to force it upon the text because the text speaks for itself. And that's how really good preaching and teaching ought to happen. We don't have to somehow impress with the Word of God. We don't have to enforce our opinions or our interpretation on it. We just simply need to let the Word of God speak for itself. And the Word of God simply says there's something that the Lord delights in. And if it says there's something the Lord delights in, guess what? We ought to be trying to figure out what is it that the Lord delights in. What is it that makes the Lord happy? I want you to know something. In social media, there's something that's called an emoji where individuals will select a particular facial expression in order to indicate how they feel about a certain day, how they feel about their job, how they feel about being in a relationship, how they feel about something that's been said to them. But I want you to know the idea of an emoji was not created during modern times. It was created actually in eternity past. Because you'll read in the Bible over and over again, it says that there are times when God's heart is grieved. There are times, as a matter of fact, you'll see in John chapter 11 when Lazarus died, we see that God in the form of Jesus actually wept and cried. The text here says that there's something that literally makes the Lord smile. Now, I don't know about you, but I want to find out what is it that's going to make the Lord smile. Now, I can't always try to figure out what is it going to make you smile, and you can't always figure out what's going to make me smile, but the Bible does tell us there's something that will make the Lord smile. Listen, it says, and again, I do that for those who don't have long attention spans. I'll give you the Cliff Notes version, then I'll go back and explain in detail. It says, what makes the Lord smile is when we have knowledge of God and when we understand and know who he is. And you might say, preacher, that's quite simple. Well, it's not really simple in our modern day and time. J. LaRue is a preaching professor at Princeton University, and he writes a book that is entitled Rethinking Celebration, and his book is geared specifically towards the African-American church that has majored on celebration. And while he would not want to take the emotive aspect out of our celebratory experience, he says that we have gravitated so much toward the celebratory experience that we are illiterate when it comes to the Word of God. So you'll find that in many of our churches, my brothers and sisters, we celebrate but we don't think. And the fact of the matter is, the Bible said you've got to think and faith. But many of us don't want to think. We don't want to know more about God. But the Bible says what makes the Lord happy is when we are learning more and more about him. He said, I delight when you understand and know me. There are a whole lot of folk who are emoting Sunday after Sunday but don't know nothing about God. the Bible. They can't find revelation in the Bible. They don't even have a go-to verse when they have a little old bitty bad day. Somebody talk to me in this place. Listen, Theophilus J. LaRue says, we've got to somehow rethink celebration.
Yes.
And we don't eliminate celebration, but we've got to have a balance between what we know about God,
oh, yes,
which should naturally lead to a celebratory experience. But it's got to start in the pulpit. Because he said rethinking celebration has to start in the pulpit. Because a whole lot of preachers focus so much on the end of their sermon and ain't saying nothing when they get to the end and everybody out there shouting. So we just celebrating when ain't nothing ain't been said. So we got to start, listen, when you challenge folk from the pulpit to think before you shout. Sometimes that means you got to dig in the Word of God and say some stuff that folk may not want to hear. You got to make them think, make them go to school, make them study the Word of God from the pulpit. Then your emotions will be based on truth. Listen, our emotional rejoicing and worship grows stronger and stronger while our understanding of scripture and theology grows weaker and weaker. There are churches that are growing astronomically on emotion with no biblical truth being taught. But when biblical truth is being taught, you see authentic celebration. The Lord says, I don't care where you worship me, whether on this mountain or that mountain. I want you to worship me in spirit, emotion, and in truth. You've got to have both. You can't just have spirit without truth, because the spirit only points to truth. As a matter of fact, the Holy Spirit does not draw attention to himself, does not even want his name called. The Holy Spirit said, I will point you to Jesus.
Yeah.
Yeah. Listen, my brothers and sisters, we need to understand. And Theophilus J. LaRue quotes a book that was written 30 years ago, a book written by Neil Postman, and that book was entitled Amusing Ourselves to Death. Neil Postman, in his book Amusing Ourselves to Death, noted that television was making us sillier by the minute. He said the decline of print-based epistemology has been replaced with television-based epistemology. Now let me explain what he means there. There was a generation who had to listen to radio and read newspaper. And reading and listening makes you think and formulate your own opinion and figure out what something means. But when print journalism and when radio was replaced by television and looking, people don't think. They just simply want to be amused, and they believe whatever they see. Somebody talk to me in this place. So there has been a dumbing down, even in the church, because we don't want to read. We don't even want to open our Bible when the text is announced. Somebody talk to me in this place. We don't want to listen. We just want to watch. Some folks, even in churches on Sunday morning, they are replacing the preaching of the Word of God with movies. Now listen, God did not put us here. Amusement is not going to save you. It is only the challenge and the interrogation of the Word that will save you. Listen, we are amusing ourselves to death, and because of that, we are getting sillier and we are getting dumber by the minute. Listen, my brothers and sisters, Jeremiah here in our text says that there are two things that the Lord delights in. 3 John verse 4 says there's no greater joy that the Lord has than people know and love the Lord.
Yes.
We need to understand that studying of the Word of God with an open seeking heart, being guided by the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
Listen, this, my friends, will give you knowledge,
yes,
and it will affect change in your life. The Word of God is transformational truth. And this is what Jeremiah is saying in our text. Listen, Jeremiah speaks of three things that the world and that men delight in. He said men and people delight in wisdom, we delight in strength, and we delight in riches. Matter of fact, those we put on a pedestal, those we think are the smartest, those we think are the strongest, and those we think are the wealthiest.
Yeah.
In fact,
of the matter is, Jeremiah wants us to understand these things cannot ward off disaster, or can they get ward off the Lord's displeasure. Listen, if we see anything else with the hurricanes that have come through and earthquakes that are taking place, if we don't know anything else, we'll realize there ain't no human being smart enough to stop those things from happening. There's no human being strong enough to hold back the barriers of water. And there's no human being rich enough to buy themselves out of facing disaster. So we need to understand Jeremiah is saying, those things that you and I, as human beings, delight in, we better find something else to rejoice in. Something else to rejoice in. We ought to find out what makes the Lord happy. Let me tell you something. When you find out what makes the Lord happy, the Lord will do something in your mind, do something in your heart. Listen, when you know that you know, that you know that you know, that you made the Lord happy. You ain't never got no praise on until you've made
the Lord, happy. Listen, Jeremiah says, he wants us to understand that our wisdom is not like God's wisdom. Our might is not the moral strength of righteousness. Our wealth is not the spiritual riches that God has that are immune to theft and corrosion. Listen, our highest good is to know God.
Yeah.
Not simply to know God intellectually, but simply philosophically, but to know God in his true character. The source of our highest blessing, my brothers and sisters, is simply this, to know God.
Yeah.
And not simply to know God on an elementary level, but Peter closes his second epistle by saying, but grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Listen, when you are the age of those children who sang, it's good to know Jesus loves me so. But by the time you get to be a youth and young adult, you ought to know something more about other than Jesus loves me so. You ought to know why the Lord loves you. And when you get beyond being a young adult and get to being an adult and go through experience and trial in life, you ought to know that the Lord can make a way somehow in your life. And you ought not just know from church euphemisms. You ought to know where the Word of God gives you a promise that the Lord will make a way. There are a whole lot of folk that shout on pews in church and don't know whether there's a biblical precedent for what you shouting about or not. But when you know there's a promise in the Word of God that God will do what you're shouting about, that becomes an authentic praise.
Amen.
So we need to understand, my friends, that in order to make the Lord happy and make the Lord smile, you've got to delight in God's spoken word.
Yeah.
And when I say delight in God's spoken word, understand that God created the world, earth, and everything we see. He created ex nihilo. He created life. He created everything out of nothing. God simply spoke. Listen, I know that many people, they say, but E.F. Hutton talks, everybody listen. But I want you to understand something. When God speaks, it has such creative force. Now, I'm not talking about it being written down. It's just simply when God spoke, everything was brought into existence. Listen, God is so powerful that when God speaks, see, listen, you need to delight in God speaking. When you hear God speaking to your heart, in your mind, God speaking in your situation, when you hear God speaking to you in worship service, you ought to delight in hearing the Word of God. But you cannot delight in the spoken Word of God if you don't know the Word of God. The Bible says, my sheep know my voice, and another they will not listen to. But if you have not immersed yourself in the Word of God, if His voice is an unfamiliar voice, the Bible says in 1 Corinthians, if they don't know the sound of the trumpet, they'll be marching to battle under the wrong banner. But you don't need to listen to an uncertain sound. You need to know the sound of the voice of the Lord. A lot of us talking about we're looking forward to the Lord coming back. But the fact of the matter is, it says there's going to be a shout, there's going to be the archangel, and then there's going to be the voice of the Lord. And a whole lot of us, because his voice is so unfamiliar, we're going to sleep right through the rapture. Because we don't know his voice. But I know you want something. When I see him, I would have heard his voice first. And when I hear his voice, I'm going to know his voice more than I know my mama's voice, my daddy's voice, my wife's voice, my son or my grandson. When I hear his voice, I'm going to know it's his voice. And I'm going to say amen, and I'm going to be ready to go. My question to you, do you delight in the spoken word of God?
God's powerful word written down. The wonderful thing about God, he didn't simply speak so we could forget.
Yeah.
He spoke and had it written down so that we could go back and reflect and read the things that God has said. So listen, my brothers and sisters, Bible says in Psalm 1, blessed, listen, it says when we meditate on the law of the Lord day and night, we shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, and whatsoever we do shall prosper. Our leaf will not wither, and whatsoever we do will not perish. When Joshua was getting ready to take over from Moses, the Lord told Joshua, be strong and of good courage, and you and the children of Israel meditate on the law of the Lord. So much so, he told them to wear phylacteries, which were at wrist of bracelets, that didn't have the planes they were going to run, but it had the written word of God on their wrist. He said, put it over your doorpost so you can read it when you go out and read it when you come in. And he said, you need to delight in the written word of God.
Yeah.
The conviction that the Bible is the word of God is the testimony of the Bible itself. You'll find in Exodus 17, 14, Isaiah 30, verse 8, Jeremiah 30, verse 2, 2 Timothy 3, 16, the Bible tells you itself. It don't need no scientists, no archaeologists. The Bible says itself that it is the written word of God.
Amen.
You got delight in God's spoken word.
Yes.
Delight in God's written word. Then you've got to delight in God's incarnate word.
Yes.
Listen, God's incarnate word is Jesus, the Son of God. The youth and young adults sang about the cosmic and universal love of God. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. That Son is Jesus. Jesus is the powerful word of God. God incarnate. John chapter 1, verses 1 through 5 echoes literally Genesis chapter 1, but it identifies God's word as a person, that person being Jesus. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word is God. We need to understand that a word expresses or reveals meaning. It expresses thought, so much so that when the disciples in John chapter 14 said, Jesus, show us the Father, Jesus said, I've been with you this long, and you don't realize whoever sees me sees the Father. Listen, Jesus is the exposition. He is the exegesis. He is the interpretation of who God is in his essence, in his person. When you see Jesus, you see God. And because we don't know biblical truth, Dr. Robert Smith, who was professor at Beeson Seminary on the campus of Samford University, he says, because we don't really know God as we should, within our particular, and Dr. Robert Smith is an African-American professor, he speaks specifically to our particular contextual experience in worship. He reminds us, my friends, that worship is a verb, but God is a noun. And he says that we are good at the verb or the action of worship, but our hearts are far from him. And we cannot be satisfied with the verb of worship and not know the noun of worship. We cannot simply focus on the activity and not the person, because it's the person that leads to the activity. Y'all not praying with me in this place. And so there ought to be some thought. There ought to be something in your mind that comes as it relates to the noun or God that leads to your celebration and praise. It ought not be what you want to happen in your life. It ought not simply be what you want to be brought through your situation. Ought not be simply because you had a bad week. You ought to want to praise because you know who God is. William Murphy said, praise is what I do. Not when I want something, but when I want to be close to you. Somebody talk to me. The highest level of praise is when you simply want to be close to the Lord. Listen, there's something. This is what an intentional study in the light of the Word of God will do. There's something that's called a weaver's loom. And this literally was a machine that brings together individual strands of thread. And the weaver would skillfully blend together these separate strands, literally, into a beautiful fabric. It would weave, listen, fabrics that normally looked like they didn't go together, put them together, these strands, and they put out beautiful finished product. Well, listen, here's why we need to delight in the Word of God. Whenever you weave together the story of the biblical text and the story of your life, the story of the text both challenges and changes your story. Listen, if you want your story to change, if you want your scenario to change, you got to go to his story, and his story will change your story. His story will challenge you. His story will transform you. His story will transform your story. So if you want your Word of God. If you want your situation to stand, delight in the Word of God. Delight in the spoken Word. Delight in the written Word, but most of all, delight in the Son of God who died on the cross for your sin. The Word in flesh, full of grace and truth, who hung on the cross, died for your sin, coming back. By delighting in the spoken word, by delighting in his written word, and by delighting in his incarnate word. As we open the doors of the church, we extend the invitation to Christian discipleship. We pray for the effect of the word on the hearts of the lost and the sinner. We pray, God, that as your word has gone forth, as Isaiah declared in Isaiah 55, as the rain and snow come, may it fall upon soil that is ready. Also, God, may your word of God be like the rain and snow, some having an immediate effect, some having a much longer effect. But we just pray, Lord, that your word has an effect. As we stand all over